right, good morning, everybody. It's good to see everyone here. And I also want to welcome anyone that's joining us online this morning. I just hope that and pray that this is just an awesome morning in the presence of our Lord. So just welcome you to stand with us and we'll get right into singing. Try that again.
Hebrews chapter 1, the letter of Hebrews chapter 1, as part of worship today, I just thought it's all about Jesus, proclaiming Him and exalting Him. He's already been exalted. So this morning, just think about who He is, His position in heaven and on earth and in our hearts. Amen. Let's take it. God, who at various times in various ways spoke in time past to the fathers and by the prophets, has in these last days spoken to us by His Son. The Son is speaking to us now. Who is His Son? Whom He has appointed heir of all things. He's heir of all things. So everything in the world, see, what do you see? Belong to Him. Amen. And through whom also He made the world. So He was present at the creation. Who, being the brightness of God's glory and the express image of the person of God. In NIV it says that He is a radiance of God's glory and exact representation of God's being. So He is God. He's not just another God. He is God. Exact representation of God's being. A lot of people don't have that image of Christ in us. Christ being upheld by someone like Buddha or someone, some other religious, a religion founder or a teacher. This morning we had to get that out of our heart. Think about it. He's God. He's the express image of the majesty, glory. Amen. And who, being the brightness of God's glory and express image of by His person, and upholding all things by His powerful word. Oh, this is so powerful. If you check in Colossians chapter 1, He's the image of God's glory and He's holding everything by His powerful word. So when the powerful word is no more holding, can you believe the whole universe will collapse? Isn't that what it means? He upholding everything. His word, powerful word. So when you say His word, it has its power, significance. That power is the one holding that word. Once that word is not there anymore, can you believe everything clashes? All the atoms, molecules, and everything. I'm not a physicist. I don't know. There's so much to talk about it. But I don't want to talk this morning. Just imagine. That word is not there. The world is not longer there. We are no longer there. Everything disintegrates. That's the power of His word. Amen. This morning, as part of worship, let's understand who is this guy. Who is this Jesus? Amen. One more thing. Oh, if you, verse by verse, this Hebrews, letter of Hebrews, you know, you find Jesus, you are in a different world. Your problems and all the worries in your heart will be vanished, because the one who is in represented here is powerful. He is the only one. Come on. He is the only one. There is no one else. He is the only one. I was just going through this. I'm telling you, I'm just so excited. I cannot even express what I feel about this Jesus. Come on. Aren't we so blessed to know Him? A huge group yesterday from India, that I was thinking, my goodness, their perception of Jesus is totally different. People think about Him, someone, just a religious teacher, even Christianity, that's what they teach. In order to know the power, the Bible says very clearly, amen? Let's feel the presence this morning. Let's understand Him. And one more thing, and then I'll stop here. And He said, you know what He did for us? Wow. When He had by Himself purged our sins, He took our sins away. No longer in us. Now, sat down at the right hand of the majesty on the side. On His right side, He's standing by the right hand of the Father God. And He acquired His position by His inheritance. By His inheritance. Not by, given by anybody, not acquired by, He acquired by inheritance. That's what the Bible says. Having become so much better than the angels, And he has by inheritance obtained more excellent position than anybody else. That's the reason why he's better than angels, superior than angels, superior than Moses, superior than any prophets or any religious teachers or anyone you can ever imagine. He's superior. This is Jesus. And you know that further downwards, he's just reciting as one of the psalm here. He says, your throne, O God, is forever and ever. A scepter of righteousness is the scepter of your kingdom. You have loved righteousness and hated lawlessness. Therefore, God, your God, has appointed you with oil and gladness more than your companions. Amen. So he's not brother of Lucifer. He's not anyone, just one angel. A lot of people teach us that he's the brother of Lucifer. I don't know who's that, but I'm telling you, Jesus is the only one. No one else. That's whom we come to worship this morning. So why don't we sing? I know it's like, why don't we sing that song, Lord of All, one more time, please? I love that song. That's glorifying, and feel the lordship of Jesus in my life, your life. We don't have any, we don't care what's going on around the world, but who is the Lord of your life? Come on. Let's give him the glory and praise him. To the rock, we can come and take refuge in times of trouble. We love you, Lord. Praise you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for giving us this opportunity to worship you. Father, we commit this worship in your presence, this service, all together, sharing of the word and ministering to one another. Let everything be filled with the presence of Jesus Christ. Bless everyone. If anyone has come into this place with a lot of weight and any issues that's bothering them, Father, they may leave everything here and walk out of this door free, free indeed. Jesus, thank you, Lord. Give the glory and honor to Jesus. name we pray. Amen. Amen. As usual, why don't we give the Lord a hand this morning and praise Him, worship Him, glorify Him, shout His praise. Thank you, worship team. Why don't you give them a hand? Come on, worship team. Good job. God bless you. Again, welcome, New Victory Church. We thank you for coming this morning. And I know you have come this place to meet with God. Amen. Nothing else matters. Amen. And I hope you are having that great thought of Jesus in your heart always. Never leave that thought. And why don't you meet one another and say hi or bye or whatever you want to do and keep the distance.
All right. Good morning, everyone. I'm told it's time. So it's time. yeah. So hope we're all. How's everyone this morning? Good. Awesome. Good job, Benedicto. Yeah. No, we're blessed to be here. We're blessed to be here, and thanks for everyone watching online as well. I just want to share a few words and encourage us, everyone, with our giving again this morning. And I want to start with a verse in the book of Matthew, Matthew 6:33. We all know this verse here. It's, it says, "But seek first the kingdom of God and His righteousness, and all these things will be added to you." Right? So seek first the kingdom of God. We've talked about this in the past. Another way to say that, which is you know, put God first in everything you do, right? Seek first the kingdom of God. Put God first in everything you do. And if we're doing that in every single thing we do, we're putting God first. That includes our finances. All right. So, this last week, I just watched an amazing teaching on giving and prosperity, and the preacher shared a few things that were just so inspiring. And I'm going to share two of the things that the preacher said. This first one, it really, really challenged me. And I believe it'll challenge many of us. But first, before I share this, again, these are not my words. This would not be a truthful statement if these were my words. These are the words of the preacher. So here's what he said. I've never had a dollar come my way in my life that I haven't given a minimum of 10%, usually 20, 30, 40%. I'll give before I'll eat. I'll put God first regardless of what it costs me. Every bit of prosperity that comes my way, I give to God first. And I don't wait and pay my bills. And if it's convenient, and if I have something left over, I give to God. I'd give to God before I'd eat. I'd give to God before I put gas in my car. I'd walk, I'd mooch a ride. I'm laughing at that. It's just so amazing, and it was so inspiring. And you know, had I heard that 3.5 years ago, the chance of me being able to relate to it in any way was zero. Right? I'd been a believer for about 4 years at the time, a little over 3 years ago, and I wasn't putting God first in my finances. I was giving a little, but I wasn't trusting with my finances. And as many of you know, my great friend in BC gave me 8 words from the Lord in 2018, 2019. His name is Daryl, and you know, in June 2018, he gave me the word from the Lord: bring the full tithe into the storehouse, test me in this, and see if I'll not pour out so much blessing there will not be room enough to store it. And I knew that word was from the Lord. And since then, I've been obedient to that word. I've been you know, giving at least 10% or more of my income consistently to God's kingdom since then. And it's only through the work that God has done in my heart in this process in the last few years that I can now say that I can start to relate to what that preacher said, right? And he said something else that was also quite amazing that I'll share. And I believe this now. Had I heard this 3.5 years ago, I would not have believed it. But again, only through the work that God's done in my heart, I truly believe this to be the truth right now. Here's what else he said. When you get to where you put God's kingdom first, and you are living to establish God's kingdom, and that's what it's all about, then God will take care of your needs supernaturally. God becomes responsible for your needs. When you get to where you truly put God first, God takes over taking care of you. Yeah, it's not my words, but I just wanted to share that with everyone this morning. And I was just so inspired by that. I hope we all are here today. And so again, just want to encourage us to seek first the kingdom of God, put God first in everything we do, put God first in our finances, and the more that we put God first with our finances, the more our heart's going to belong to God and not to our possessions. And the more that our heart belongs to God, the more we're going to become our lives are going to revolve around seeking first his kingdom and establishing his kingdom. And God will bless us in the process so that we can bless others and bless his kingdom. Amen? All right. So for those of you who want to give, there's a giving station at the back online, newvictory.ca, you can give. Father, I thank you. I thank you for this opportunity to gather and worship. Father, we are so blessed to be here this morning. Father, and I just thank you. I pray that you do the work in all of our hearts, Lord. Help us to all to get to the point where we're seeking first the kingdom of God. Our lives, Father, revolve around what can we do to further your kingdom, Lord. We are so blessed, Lord. You gave us your one and only Son, Jesus Christ, so that we can have that everlasting life, Lord, and just help us to do the work in our hearts, Lord. Help us to have all givers' hearts and seek first your kingdom, Lord, so that we can be a blessing to others and to your kingdom, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Well, thank you guys for your generosity. I just want to make it very clear that you know, oftentimes when we give, we think, oh, you know, I give my money. It's like in the church this and the church that. We have to realize it's the same as back in the Old Testament. They gave their tithe because of God, not because the temple needed stuff and not because the priest needed to be taken care of. Did the temple need stuff and did the priest need to be taken care of? Yes, but that was secondary. That was always secondary. People gave because of God, right? And you guys know me. You know that's our heart here. I want to see you guys give and be blessed and be tithers. Remember we said last week that God rebukes the devourer for you, right? That's just amazing. So I want to just say thanks, James, for sharing that. And you may not have wrote the words, but you delivered them. By the way, I didn't write these words. I just deliver them every week. So, hey, you know, that you're in good company, right? And that challenged me. And I'm going to be completely honest here this morning because after we did our budget this week, and I'm not saying this for anyone to do anything, so don't. I'm telling you right now. I'm just sharing it because I want you to know that what he shared is real. You know, we only had about $80 spending money, right, when we were done our budget this week. My wife's probably not wanting me to share about that, but I'm going to. On the way to church this morning, I asked her, you know, how much are we tithing this morning? And I don't usually tell you this, but I'm going to tell you for sake of this testimony. She said 318. And all of a sudden, the devil's coming along. He says, boy, wouldn't it be nice to have 318 instead of 80 for spending money? Right? And I'm not going to tell you that I didn't think about it for a few minutes. Okay? But we gave our tithe this morning. I'm not saying that to brag. I'm just saying that, hey, look what the Lord just spoke to me this morning, the pastor. Okay? And by the way, we're a single income house. My wife works darn hard at what she does with our kids and all the, I can't even believe all the stuff she does. It's amazing. But we've been a single income house almost our whole lives, and God has always provided. Amen. Right? I was using my $999 laptop the other night, and I'm thinking, here we are, a single income family, and I need it, by the way, for what I do, the Word of the King video editing. You guys know that I do that. I needed it. It's a tool. I need it. But how can you afford that, being a single income family? Because we give to God, and God gives back. That's how. I love that. That was so good, James. That challenged me this morning. So thank you. And nobody be doing anything about what I said, okay, because the Lord's providing, okay? I just shared it so that you say, hey, man, that hit me right at home this morning. The pastor. All right. Well, love you guys. Bless you guys. Man, the worship team was hot this morning. Holy smokes. Like, seriously, I think they all left. Yay. Oh, no, Stephanie's still there. There we go. Man, just like, and I don't mean, yeah, there you go. Dustin, you're behind the pole. We need to meet at the pole. There we go. Prayer at the pole. I don't know. It was there was an anointing. But there was an, you know, anointing that's there, but there's also an anointing on the music. Like there was, in the music, I was like, man, getting chills. Because I go out in the cappuccino bar to go on my phone and open up the channel to make sure all of our sound's good for our viewers. And I was just like, man. Anyways, so awesome, guys. Thank you for being faithful to the Lord. Well, we're still in our series, The Character and Nature of God. I'm thinking, man, we're on part 7. But I promise you there won't be 30 parts. We'll stop here sooner or later, but, you know, we're talking about the character of God, and as we said before, you know, the depths of God are just unending, just amazing. And, of course, you know, the premise, of course, for those who maybe are just joining us for this series is that you can't really trust someone until you know their character and nature. And even as Christians, many times we know God really well in one way, especially if we went to a church that taught only certain characteristics of God. You understand what I'm saying? I grew up in some churches that they never talked about certain characteristics of God. They never really went to the book of Acts, right? I'm serious. I went to a church for about 3 or 4, maybe 5 years of my life, and the book of Acts was never opened because it talked about the Holy Spirit and the power and the miracles. It's crazy, eh? But anyways, so even in your upbringing, you may not know a particular part of the character of God. And so there's so many, but they mostly tie into main ones like we've been dealing with, that he's our protector, he's our provider, he's our deliverer. And what's funny is I said to my wife, this week was getting on a little, and I'm like, I don't know which one I'm going to talk about this week. And she kind of looked at me and she smiled, but she didn't say anything. And I went, but I was kind of leaning towards God is good. She's like, that's exactly what I was just about to say. Wow. Isn't that awesome? So Holy Spirit speaks to us, and to us too, not just the individuals, but to us and through us. So last week was God is our deliverer. If you missed that, please check that out. That was a really good time together. But God is good. You know, let me tell you, there is We know there's so many characteristics of God, right? We know that. His nature and his characteristics, are his attributes are just amazing. We have songs that have been written for thousands of years about the attributes of God. But there was really only one that the devil came after Adam and Eve in the garden over, and it was whether or not God was good. Isn't that interesting? Isn't that interesting? This is the one characteristic and the trait of God that the devil brought into question with Eve. Is God really good? He's just trying to withhold all this stuff from you. That's why I'm paraphrasing, but that's why he told you not to eat from the tree, because he knows you'll be like him or you'll have what he has, but he's withholding. I tell you right now, actually in our giving, coming back to that, that is usually the temptation that we have to get past to become generous people, because we wonder if God really will give back if we give to him. Let's just be honest, that's what we struggle with, right? And I can tell you there's been enough testimonies through the years that he does. God says, see if I will not, right? And so, but this is the one that the devil came after. I'll tell you guys here this morning, I have personally known more people to walk away from God over the issue of him, whether or not he's good or not, than anything else, than any other characteristic. I'm saying for me personally, I've known a lot of people to walk away and abandon the faith, and it was usually over the question of whether or not God was good because of something that happened in their lives. Amen? And so that's a big thing. And in order for us to trust that God is good, of course, our premise is that we must have no doubt that he is. Regardless of what we see, of what we feel, of what we hear, right? God being good can't change for us if we're going to trust that he's good. He can't be good and then not good and then good and not good. He can't be our provider and then not our provider, right? I've heard people say, well, Paul went through times when he didn't have food. He went through times, correct, but he didn't die from not having food because he eventually got food, amen? So there's times when it's tough. I love it when the part where the guy said, I'll give before I eat. I thought of Varghese when you shared about the widow and Elijah last week. She was asked to give what she had left to eat. That's crazy. And the prophet had the gall to ask her that. God is good, though. He came through when she did it. Of course, Varghese shared that last week. We must know without any doubt that God is good regardless of the trials and the hardships in our lives. We must know this by faith, which goes beyond what we can see, hear, or feel. Faith only comes through the word. Faith only comes through the word. See, we know this as believers, but many times when we're going through hard times, we begin looking more like Peter did to the storm than to Jesus and stay afloat on the water. And then we start sinking and sinking because we're looking at how bad the storm is or how hard the trial is, and we're beginning to doubt, did Jesus really tell me to come to him on the water? And that's what happens. And the Bible actually tells us, we're not going to get into this too much this morning, but James tells us that these trials come for the sake of that, which is what? To test your faith. By the way, it doesn't say God sends them. It says these trials come. You see the difference? In this world, you will have trials. It doesn't say in this world, God will send them to you. Come on, church. He can. We see sometimes in the scripture, but that's not the predominant place or person that they come from. And what I mean by that is there was times that God allowed certain things in Israel, remember? Right? But it was because of their disobedience. It wasn't out of his, out of him trying to be wrathful or anything. It was because of their disobedience. So I love this. David, King David knew this, what we're talking about here this morning. He knew this. He knew that he knew this. In Psalm 27:13, let's bring up the first scripture there, guys, the first slide. David said, you guys know this passage, I would have lost heart. Somebody say, I would have lost heart. Now, let me ask you, how many of you ever been in that place? I felt like I was going to lose heart. I'm sure we've all been in that place throughout our lives. And I know it's relative. We talked about persecution last week. Persecution is relative. Just because someone has way worse persecution doesn't mean that your less persecution isn't persecution. Does that make sense? Okay. Just like wealth is relative, persecution is relative. But David says, I would have lost heart. What does he say? Unless I had believed. Now, so this is an NKJV. Some of the different versions I find change it even more. But I like trying to get back to the closer of the King James version. I would have lost heart unless I had believed. What? What did he believe? He believed something very specific. that I would see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. So he would have lost hope, and it doesn't say unless he saw God's power, which is awesome to see God's power, right? It doesn't say if I had seen God's protection, even though God protected David. As a matter of fact, he's talking here about losing heart, probably because of all the stuff that went on. We just got finished 1 and 2 Samuel with our kids, and we can't believe what David went through to get to the throne. It was brutal. I mean, Joseph was in prison, but I mean, which is bad, but David was chased, and Saul tried killing him, right? And so we see the psalmist here say that. I would have lost heart unless I had believed. Folks, what did he believe? He believed in the goodness of God. Remember in Psalm 119, he said, I have hidden your word in my heart that I may not sin against you. David knew of God's goodness, yes, from experience, secondary, but firstly, he knew of God's goodness because God declared himself as good. Amen? So David believed the word of God. And he said if he didn't believe the word of God about God's goodness, he would have lost hope. At what point do we give up? When we lose hope. Right? That's why there is faith, there is hope, and there is love. Love is the greatest, but we still need all three. Amen? We still need all three. That's why Paul mentions them there. He would have lost hope. What? Unless he had have believed in the goodness of God. Right? Unless I had have believed that I would see. Notice he's saying that I would see. That's faith. He didn't say, I would have lost hope unless I had experienced God's goodness. He doesn't say that. He says, I would have lost hope if I hadn't have believed that I would see it. Jesus said, whatever you're believing for, whatever you ask for, believe that you have received it and you will. How many of you know it doesn't necessarily mean that exact moment? It can, but it doesn't necessarily mean that exact moment. You guys following me? When you pray for something and you're believing for something, you believe that you have it just as much as I can hold this phone in my hand until I get the phone and it actually is physically in my hand. Our whole faith life is this. I don't see myself as a manifest son of God, but the Bible says that that revealing is coming. I believe it, and I won't lose hope because I believe it. Paul calls it our blessed hope. Right? I've never seen Jesus. I don't know if any of you guys have. I know people have had visions and stuff like that, and that's fine. But I haven't seen him and touched him like Thomas did. But Jesus said, for you disciples, you know, you believe in me because you see me. But blessed are those who believe in me, though they've never seen me. Because that takes more faith. Right? It takes more faith. It takes faith to believe in the goodness of God even before you've experienced it. Right? In this moment, whatever is causing him to lose heart. And then second to the word, is experience. How many of you know that we don't throw experience out the door? Amen? Amen, church? This is full of experiences, isn't it? Right? But it's full of people that had experiences because they believed before the experience. As faith, right? And then they saw it come to pass. Actually, Hebrews Heroes of Faith, chapter 11, it says some of them never even seen what they were believing for. And then the writer tells us clearly the coming kingdom of Christ. They never got to see that. And then the writer says, why? Because we're all meant to receive it together. Isn't that awesome? And so we live like they do. Why? Because we believe that God is good. He is good. You know, I don't believe that's the point of this morning, but I do want to give you three scriptures right in a row, like bang, 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 about that God is good, okay? So next slide here, guys, because the scripture is full of scriptures of God being good. But here we go. 1 Chronicles 16:34. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. Nahum, you don't hear that quoted from much, do you? Nahum 1:7, the Lord is good, a stronghold in the day of trouble. Mark 10:18, Jesus himself declared, no one is good but one, and that one is God. But my mission isn't to prove that the Bible says that God is good here this morning, because we know that as Christians. The Bible says. My mission here this morning is for us to believe that God is good no matter what is going on in our lives. Are you following me? That's what the Holy Spirit told me this morning. He said that you're not trying to convince people this morning that God is good. but the fact that he is good no matter what's going on in your life, because that's where people tend to trip up over whether or not God is good. Does that make sense? Okay, and so that's what we need to hear this morning. So God is good, we know it. That's three out of literally hundreds, if not thousands, of scriptures that talk about the fact that God is good. Now, this is where this is the nitty-gritty I said that we want to get into. However, not all that appears good is necessarily God. Not all that appears good is necessarily God. I can say it this way. God is good, but good isn't necessarily God. You'll see what I'm saying here in a minute. Just remember that point. Because God, who is good, told Adam and Eve not to eat from the tree because that would be bad. Okay, following you. What's the big deal? Genesis 3, 6 to 7. Look at this. Next slide, guys. When Eve saw that the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eyes, and that it was desirable for obtaining wisdom, she took the fruit and ate it. And she also gave some to her husband, who knew even better than she did that they were not supposed to eat from the tree, by the way, who was with her. He ate it. And the eyes of both of them were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they felt ashamed. Listen, what they thought was good made them feel bad. What they thought was good made them feel bad. They felt ashamed. Is ashamed good or bad? It's bad. Just think of the puppy dog when you get after him and he's like, that's right. That's how you feel. What they thought was good, we all now know through one man sin came, Adam, because of one thing that they decided, even though God said it wasn't good, was good. Amen? So let me tell you something here this morning. There's good and then there's God, right? Things that appear good may not be God. So we learned this lesson from Adam and Eve. Don't simply make what looks like good decisions in our lives. We need to make godly ones. Don't just make what looks like good decisions in our lives. Make sure that you make godly ones. How do you know that they're godly? The word, do not eat from the tree. That was the word of God to Adam, and then we assume, anyways, that Adam would have taught that to Eve, because remember, Adam heard it first, right? Okay? And even if he didn't, she still came to him, and he could have went, no, this is wrong, we can't do this. Who knows what would have happened if that had happened, but it didn't. So God's word told them what was good, which was not to do something. How many of you know that if God said you can just do whatever you want, right? If God said you can just do whatever you want, a lot of people in the world would think that was good. How many of you know the world wants to do whatever they want, with whoever they want, whenever they want, and they call that good? Amen? Let me tell you, that's the tree. That's the tree. It seems good. It seems pleasing, and it seems desirable, and the Bible says it is for a season, but then it leads to death. But initially, they perceived it as good. Why am I saying that? Because if God is telling us not to have something, it's for our good. Right? I mean, if you grew up in a good home, didn't you trust your parents to be like that with you? Mom and Dad's telling me not to do that. It's for my own good. And I'm sure there's nobody in the room that went against that growing up. Our perception of what is good is not always God's perception of what is good. And we need to always realize that He has a far better view than we do. No matter how well you get to know this word, you are not the Alpha and the Omega. You cannot see the beginning from the end. But we and you and I know the one who can. Amen? So you see, our perception can be that something is good, but our perception is like this when God's is like, I can't even make it as big as God's is. You understand? So I get this is what I say to people like who aren't Christians, but then they begin asking questions about, well, you Christians, you're all about what you can't do. I said, well, that's not totally true, but there are a lot of things that the Bible tells us not to do. But what I do is I explain to them, I often give them this example. I said, what if we're going to have this outdoor event, we're going to set up tents, we're going to have picnic tables, and we're going to go up on Smashing Buffalo, what's that area called? Cliff? You know, head note there towards Crow's Nest. What's it called? Jumping Buffalo? Smashing Head Buffalo. Anyways, it's a cliff. All right, so if I said we're going to have an event up there, right, we're going to have toys and we're going to have, you know, bouncy castles, we're going to have all kinds of picnics, but you know what we're not going to do, because we don't want anyone to feel limited, or, you know, we don't want to put up any boundaries. We're not going to put a fence around the cliff, so we're just going to ask you guys to watch your kids. How safe are you going to feel bringing your family there, right? So I say this to people, and then I say, but what, so in God's eyes, he sets up the fence so that we don't have to worry about our protection. And for our goodness and for our protection, there has been a boundary set, which is good. You see that? So God's laws are set up for that purpose, not to kill your joy, but to keep you from partaking in the things that really will kill your joy. You see that? And we have to understand that not that everything that appears good is good. God's perception is far better than ours. Also, what is good to God is more often what is good for us in the long run. How many of you know we live in a society today that wants instant gratification? When I put that $1.50 in the pop machine, I darn well better hear that clunk within 2 seconds. And if I don't, I'm going to start gently pushing on the machine and on the buttons. And then if I still don't get it, and it was like my last $1.50, and I'm so thirsty for some Pepsi, I'm going to start kicking it. I might go in the back and unplug it and plug it back in. And I mean, if you have a bit of rage issues, you're probably going to start trying to tip the thing. Please don't ever do that. There's people that have died from that, actually, seriously, right? Why? Because it should have happened, right? And I think that's where we get tripped up many times, is we're believing something, right? But it hasn't happened. And then all of a sudden we make a boo-boo like Sarah did. Hey, Abraham, why don't you sleep with Hagar and create an Ishmael, right? Poor Ishmael. It wasn't even his fault. It wasn't Hagar's fault. You know that God blessed them too? Often we pick on Ishmael, but God actually blessed Hagar and Ishmael if you actually read the rest of the story. They were blessed by God. Because God is good, right? Oh, thank you, Holy Spirit. Guys, this is like, I'm not even in my notes half of the time here. This is Holy Spirit right now. How many times have we eaten of that apple and then been ashamed? And I'm saying this for myself, and you can think of it for yourself too. How many times have I knowingly eaten from the apple? I just don't even care. I just have to do this right now. I don't care. I'm just going to go get drunk this weekend. I don't even care. I seen a meme on Facebook the other day. I'm like, shut up. The person's like, they're like, happiness can't be found at the bottom of a bottle, but I like to try. I bet you're probably on your 500th time. Keep trying, right? I know it was supposed to be funny and a joke, but I don't find it funny at all. By the way, I don't have a problem with wine in moderation and all that kind of stuff. I'm talking about drunkenness. The Bible says that's wasteful living. Okay? You see the difference? It says that your deacon shouldn't be addicted to much wine. If I call my deacon and he can't drive someplace to come and pray because he can't stay on the road, we're going to have a talk. Right? But we think that these things are good. And I know I hung out in that crowd for about a year of my life. And at first, oh, sin was pleasure for that season. Until the season was over, and then I realized how gross the flesh is. The flesh is literally gross. It literally is. You know, we say it leads to death, but if you think about death, death is rotting flesh. And I always tell young people that are being tempted and they're struggling, I'm like, think of sin as rotting flesh. Ew, perfect. You got it, right? That's what it's like. Huh, yeah. and death came in with them eating of the apple, right? Things rotting, the earth having us have to really struggle to get things out of the earth. Do you know that Adam and Eve didn't have to struggle at first? They didn't work the land at that time by the sweat of their brow. The sweat of their brow came in with the curse, right? But it all was because they took what they thought was good when God told them it wasn't good because his perception was better than theirs. See, you have to trust that God is good or you're going to end up eating of the apple. But thank God for his grace and his mercy. Amen. That if we confess our sins, that he is faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness, 1 John 1:9. So this is not a condemning message, but this is, hey, let's learn from this message, right? Let's grow. Paul says, let's grow up in these things, right? Let's grow past the basic things of salvation and those things. What is good to God is more often what is good for us in the long run. In other words, we like to think that what is good, listen folks, should only come packaged in a way that is pleasurable and painless. As a matter of fact, we identify pleasurable and painless as good. Let's be honest, that ends up being our perception of it because we live in a world that believes that. We live in a world that believes that, right? I do want to say, however, that many of the things that God gives us are. God gives us, I mean, salvation for you shouldn't have been painless. When you believed, I mean, it was because Jesus took all the pain for that. You just said, Jesus, I believe in you. You might have went through some stuff before that. I get that. But you, that stuff you went through didn't earn your salvation. It showed you that you needed it. So the gifts of God are given. There's no pain in those. It wasn't painful for me to receive the Holy Spirit. Amen? So God gives us things that are packaged in pleasurable and painless things. A great example is James 1:17, part A. It says, every good and every perfect gift is from the Father in heaven, the Father of lights. Matthew 7:11, Jesus said, if you being evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Father in heaven give good gifts to those who ask? And he was speaking of the Holy Spirit. That's not painful. That's not a hardship to receive the Holy Spirit. As a matter of fact, all they had to do was wait in Jerusalem, right? They weren't like, oh gosh, we're in pain, this is really hard. They just waited and prayed. So God gives us pleasurable gifts that aren't painful. 1 Timothy 6:17, I don't have them up there because it's just little blips of scripture I wanted to give you. Paul says, God richly gives us all things for our what? Enjoyment. Look at that. You know that God gives you things just to enjoy, just as much as any good, loving parent would do. So he does do that, right? But the things that we go through in this life are not always pleasurable and painless. They can be difficult and they can be painful. And again, as I said before, God doesn't necessarily cause these hardships and trials. But I can tell you this, he will never waste them. Let me say that again. God does not necessarily cause the hardship and the trials, but I can tell you that he will not waste them. There's a difference between him ordaining something and him saying, you're going through this, but this is what I'm going to do. Jesus, remember, said, if you give up homes and lands and families for the sake of my name and my gospel, you will receive 100 more times in this life and in the one to come amidst persecutions. Amen. Would you rather go through persecution without the goodness of God or with it? Come on. The Bible says that Mary was highly favored among women. Yet Herod was chasing them down, trying to kill their firstborn son. But here she was, blessed and favored. Being blessed and favored doesn't mean that we won't go through hard things in life. It means that we have God's blessing, favor, and goodness through those things. And I would much rather have it through them than not have it to go through them. God will embed his purpose for our good in them and through them. See, he's not necessarily ordaining or causing them. I get that. But he will embed his good purpose in them because he will not waste anything. Are you following me here this morning? I'm not trying to go back on saying that, oh, I believe God makes people sick to teach them a lesson now. That's not what I'm saying. I'm saying when we go through hard things, God will not waste that. He will embed or interject his goodness into it. And quite honestly, if we didn't have that, then like David, we would have lost hope and we would lose heart. True? True? But we keep heart because we know God is good and we know that we'll see it in the land of the living. Joseph said to his brothers, let's bring up that next slide there. Joseph said in Genesis 50, verse 20, what you intended against me for evil, God has turned for good. Listen, in order to. Somebody say, in order to.
In order to.
That is purpose and that is destiny. And Joseph saw the culmination of that through the trials that he went through before that. Okay? God has turned what you meant for evil for good in order to accomplish a day like this. Listen, to preserve the lives of many people. The hardest way to go through pain and hardships, the hardest way is to go through them without knowing that there is a purpose and a destiny to it. Right? The hardest way to go through, which we all will go through hardships, the hardest way to go through them is to go through them without knowing there's a purpose, without knowing there's a destiny. Why am I saying that? Because how do you know if the hardships and trials that you've gone through, that maybe you're going through right now, or that you're going to go through in the future, aren't going to end up preserving many lives? And the devil loves to come and say, oh, you can't think that about yourself. This was Joseph. It's out of the Bible. Forget that junk. God's purpose and destiny for your life doesn't stop when you have hardships and trials. That's the point I'm trying to make. Amen? As a matter of fact, I believe that they can shine even greater through that. Paul said, I'll glory in my weaknesses, right? By the way, he wasn't talking necessarily about sinful weaknesses, even though he had sin that he had to deal with in his life, you know, temptations and stuff just as much as we did. He was talking about the weaknesses of his flesh. Do you know in one of Peter's letters, he talks about how people didn't like Paul's preaching. Did you guys know that? Paul wrote 2/3 of the New Testament, and there was people in some of the churches that they said his letters are weighty and whatever, but in person his presentation is weak. Paul, the apostle. So if someone says to you, I don't think you're really a great preacher, you know, I don't know if you really present well, you're in good company. Don't get me wrong, we should get better at communicating because we want people to hear the word and the truth, not because we want people to go, oh, you're amazing. I get that. But Paul said he gloried in his weaknesses. But it wasn't just that, it was also the hardships and trials that he went through. He even said that his chains brought glory to God. His chains made a way for him to get the letters to the churches. They provided an opportunity. I love Dr. George. He says this all the time. He says, in every hardship or in every trial, there's an opportunity. But if we're too busy being like, oh, poor me, you know, Eeyore, I should have known it would happen to me, you'll miss it. You'll miss it. That's why James says crazy things like rejoice. Really? Yeah. There's an opportunity here. I'm not telling you guys that I'm a professional at this morning just because I'm speaking it. I'm speaking it because it's true of the Word of God. Amen? I'm learning this just as much as you are, but I can tell you I'm far better at it now than when I was 22. Okay? Because I've learned to rejoice in my trials better than I did then. My wife still gets to hear me whine sometimes. But I hope she would agree with me that it's not like back then. Well, actually, we weren't married until I was 24, right? So, and then that was a honeymoon year, so you wouldn't have known any of that whining. I probably never let my hair down until I got around the 25, 26 mark. She's not saying anything because she's amazing. But anyways. Are you guys getting this morning, though? You know, it's not a heavy message. It's like, man, if I get this, this is good. Right? This really is good because it's God. If you hear anything today, hear this. Our experience of either pleasure or pain does not determine the goodness of God. This feels great, it must be good. This feels horrible, must be bad. It's actually not true. That's worldly, earthly, carnal thinking. Amen? Yeah. I mean, what you're going through, right? If you're sick in your body and diseased and you feel like you're about to die, that's not good. How many of you know sickness is a part of the curse? Does anybody know that? Why would God ever use the curse to teach you a lesson? Come on, church. Right? I'm talking about when things feel not pleasurable. What you're going through, there's pressure. It's like, this is not fun. This is not good. No, it is good. Because it's an opportunity, right? It's an opportunity. Man, I'm preaching to myself just as much to you this morning, I'll tell you. Our experience of either pleasure or pain does not determine the goodness of God. Why? Because he is good regardless of our circumstances. And as a matter of fact, we need him to be. As a matter of fact, I need him to be good more in my seasons of pain and hardship than I do in my times of peace. I really do. He never changes. Now, we read the first part of James when I gave you James, every good and perfect gift, right? Comes from 16, sorry. I think I might have had the wrong reference there. I apologize. But the next part says, for he has no shadow of turning, which means he will never change. Every good and perfect gift comes down from the Father, and that'll never change. Did you ever see it that way? Every good and perfect gift comes down from the Father of lights, and he will never change. He has not even a hint of changing. As a matter of fact, he declared to himself, to Israel of himself, I am the Lord, I do not change. Our circumstances do, because they are subject to change in this earth, present earth that we're living in. But God is not subject to change. Isn't that good? His word is not subject to change. I don't care how good of a theologian a person is. They have no right to change his word because his word is not subject to change. Amen? Somebody say, God is good in my hardships just as much as he's good when things are easy. Right? Right? My brother George, you're going to love this. Romans 8, 28. And you've probably been thinking about it the whole message. This is one of his favorite passages, mine too. Romans 8, 28. And I love the way the NIV says it. And we know. Stop there. Do you know? Do you know? We should. But Paul says very confidently here, and we know. What do we know? We know that in all things, God works for the good. Of who? Of we. We know. Who are we? We are those who love God and have been called according to his purpose. Those who know that we love God and we're called according to his purpose, we know that God, in all things, works for our good. It doesn't matter what we're going through. It doesn't matter what we're experiencing. Even if it doesn't feel good or look good, we know that God will work in whatever is happening. And if it's evil that's happening, the Bible tells us it's evil, God will turn that evil for our good. The Bible doesn't tell us that no weapon will ever rise up against us. The Bible never promises that no weapon will rise up against you. As a matter of fact, it promises that it will. But the other side of that is the prophet Isaiah says, but it will not prosper. It won't succeed. Oh, there's weapons rising up against me. Come on, guys, we all do it. Come on. You don't understand? This weapon's been risen up against me. And then the second part of that actually is that every tongue that rises up, God will condemn. Wow. And by the way, that actually is speaking more towards the adversary. But you can apply it too with evil men. Jesus was persecuted at the hands of evil men, right? They were condemning themselves before God with their own words, right? We know that in all things, God works for the good of those who love him and who have been called according to his purpose. It doesn't say God sends bad things to teach us good. It says that he turns, right, before that he turns what was meant for evil. God's not going to send to you what was meant for evil. Amen? The Bible says God is not tempted and he tempts no one. Come on, church, right? But when evil is sent, when the flood comes in, God raises up a standard, right? Why? Because you need the standard because of the flood, right? And what is God's standard? His goodness. Isn't that awesome? Let's stand up in the place in this house today. We're speaking of the character and nature of God. And today, as God is good, that's just who he is. And who he is determines everything that he does because God is good. Amen? God is good. Everything he does is good. Let's pray. Father, I thank you so much for this time today. I thank you for your word. Lord, I believe this is such a timely word. I believe this is a word we need to hear at least once a year, if not more, Father, because the devil comes for the sake of the seed of the word. That's what he did with Eve. The word was do. You can have anything that you want in this whole realm of the garden, but you cannot eat from this tree. God, the devil comes and he tries to get us to eat from that tree. And Father, I pray that you would help us to see and help us to know through your word. We know what is good because of your word. That's how we know. We can't go by our senses. We can't go by sight, smell, feeling. Actually, the Lord just gave me a picture really quick. Do you know that you could have an amazing roast beef dinner sitting in front of you and it smell and look amazing, but it could be laced with cyanide? You know that? That it's hypothetical, right? And that's the thing, is the devil makes it look so good. I can tell you right now that he doesn't do anything different than he's done from the beginning. He comes and he tries to tempt you with lust of the eyes, with lust of the flesh, and with the pride of life. All he does is put it in different packages, but when you open up the package, it's one of those three things every time. John says, all that is in the world, the lust of the eyes, lust of the flesh, and the pride of life. And that is what Adam and Eve were tempted with. Father, we thank you in Jesus' name. As Jesus told us to pray, that you lead us not into temptation, right? But deliver us from evil. Jesus prayed for his disciples that Father, that you would guard them from the evil one as they're in this world. Father, I pray that for this flock this morning. I pray that for anybody that's watching online here this morning, God, that you would help us and that you would protect us. So Lord, we thank you for that. And we also thank you for your Holy Spirit and for your word. David said, I've hidden your word in my heart so that I may not sin against you. What did he mean by that? I have your word in my heart, and that shows me what's good, what is God, and what is not. And that's how we know. The Bible actually says, from constant use of the word, we come to know how to discern between good and evil. That's how we know, through the word. So Father, I thank you that you help us to know you, to know your word, to know good from evil. And Lord, even as Paul said in Romans, that we would rejoice in what is good and we would be innocent of evil. Father, in Jesus' name, in a day that we live in where evil is being called good and good is being called evil, Father, for your love, you know, for your sake, Lord, help us to know better than that. Help us to know better than that. Help us to know your word. And I want to pray for anyone here this morning, if you've been going through a hardship in life. And I want to pray for a spiritual happening here this morning. And what I mean by that is I believe the Holy Spirit's going to touch you in a special way, whether you're in this room today or you're watching online. You've gone through a hardship. Maybe you're still reeling in your life. If you're completely honest, you're still reeling, you're still seething a little bit about a hardship that you went through years ago. And I'm going to be quite honest, as I sense the unction of the Holy Spirit, you've even been mad at God because you feel that he maybe abandoned you, or you feel like he wasn't there and he wasn't good. I want to tell you here this morning that he was there and he was good. It's just that many times we're blind to that goodness because of the lack of our perception. He was there the whole time. He was with you the whole time. And as a matter of fact, he could see the outcome for you if he wasn't. You may not be able to see it, but he can. And trust me, without God, it would have been a lot worse. So, Father, we thank you for your goodness. So I pray right now, Holy Spirit, as you led me to, that your goodness would just flow and touch every person in this place today. Everyone watching online, Holy Spirit, that you would touch them with the goodness of God. I think of Moses when he asked, he's like, Lord, I want to see you. Lord, I want to see you. And then God said, Moses, prepare yourself, for I am about to pass before you. What did he say? My goodness. Isn't that what Moses saw? Moses saw God's goodness. I would have lost heart unless I saw the goodness of God in the land of the living. Holy Spirit, that's what I pray right now. As you did Moses, show each and every person in this place today, each and every person that is watching online, by your Holy Spirit, show them your goodness right now, Holy Spirit. We thank you. I'm just being obedient to you, Spirit of God. Show them your goodness. Holy Spirit, come upon them now. Fill them now with your goodness. Make their cup overflow. The joy of the Lord is my strength, and his joy is good. His joy is good. Some of you might be in, again, as I said, a trial right now. It's so hard. I thank you, Holy Spirit, that you fill them with the joy of the Lord right now. You know, the Bible says that he prepares a table for us in the presence of our enemies. Many times we think, oh, we got to wait until the end of this battle before I see a blessing. No, no, he prepares the table in the midst of the battle. And we sit down and we feast. I mean, that's just amazing. So God, I thank you that you do that for each and every person right now. Whatever that looks like for them. We're all different, Lord. You've gifted us variously, all of us. And you speak to us and touch us differently, and so it's not all the same. Lord, whatever that is for each person, Holy Spirit, thank you that you do that right now. In Jesus' mighty name. If you don't know the Lord Jesus as your Lord and Savior, and you've been listening to this message this morning, you're like, man, I've been hearing this. I heard about Jesus. I heard about God's goodness. I think I believe this. I believe this. There's something in my heart that's saying, I believe what I'm hearing. And the Bible says that if you believe in your heart that Jesus is Lord, and you will know if you do or not, then all you have to do is say it. You confess it. You say, Jesus is Lord. And the Bible says that you will be saved because you believed in your heart and because you confessed with your mouth. Father, I thank you for your word today. I thank you for your goodness in our lives. And I thank you that we don't have to worry about losing heart, because we believe that we will see your goodness in the land of the living, and we'll never stop believing it. In Jesus' name. Everybody said, come on, let's, a big one. Amen. Do you believe it? All right. Love you guys. Bless you. If you want prayer for anything, we're always here. Also, I've been loving seeing people just go and praying for one another right after the service. That's awesome. Just let's keep that going. Pray for one another, fellowship with one another. We love you. Bless you.